ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेष्वभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवतसेवया भगवती उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवती नैष्ठिकी। रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद्भागवतम कैंटो सिक्स चैप्टर वन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ द लाइफ ऑफ अजामिला। टेक्स्ट नंबर 47। वर्तमानो अन्ययो कालो वर्तमानोऽन्ययोः कालो वर्तमानोऽन्ययोः कालो गुण अभिज्ञापकः यथा गुणाभिज्ञापको यथा गुणाभिज्ञापको यथा एवं जन्म अन्ययो एतत् एवं जन्मान्ययोरेतद् एवं जन्मान्ययोरेतद् धर्म अधर्म निदर्शनम् धर्माधर्म निदर्शनम् धर्माधर्म निदर्शनम् वर्तमानोऽन्ययोः कालो गुणाभिज्ञापको यथा एवं जन्मान्ययोरेतत् धर्माधर्म निदर्शनम्। वर्तमानोऽन्ययोः कालो गुणाभिज्ञापको यथा एवं जन्मान्ययोरेतद् धर्माधर्मनिदर्शनम्। वर्तमानोऽन्ययोः कालो गुणाभिज्ञापको यथा एवं जन्मान्ययोरेतद् धर्माधर्मनिदर्शनम्। वर्तमानोऽन्ययोः कालो गुणाभिज्ञापको यथा एवं जन्मान्ययोरेतद् धर्माधर्मनिदर्शनम्। वर्तमानः द प्रेजेंट अन्ययो ऑफ द पास्ट एंड फ्यूचर कालः टाइम गुण अभिज्ञापकः मेकिंग नोन द क्वालिटीज यथा जस्ट एज एवं दस जन्म बर्थ अन्ययो ऑफ द पास्ट एंड फ्यूचर बर्थ्स एतत् दिस धर्म रिलीजियस प्रिंसिपल्स अधर्म इरिलीजियस प्रिंसिपल्स निदर्शनम इंडिकेटिंग ट्रांसलेशन एंड परपोर्ट बाय हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस एसी भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी प्रभुपाद ट्रांसलेशन Just as spring time in the present indicates the nature of spring times in the past and future, so this life of happiness, distress, or a mixture of both gives evidence concerning the religious and irreligious activities of one's past and future lives. Please repeat this translation. Just as spring time in the present indicates the nature of spring times in the past and future, so this life of happiness, distress, or a mixture of both gives evidence concerning the religious and irreligious activities of one's past and future lives. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Our past and future are not very difficult to understand, for time is under the contamination of the three modes of material nature. As soon as spring arrives, the usual exhibition of various types of fruits and flowers automatically becomes manifest, and therefore we may conclude that spring in the past was adorned with similar fruits and flowers and will be so adorned in the future also. Our repetition of birth and death is taking place within time, and according to the influence of the modes of nature, we are receiving various types of bodies and being subjected to various conditions. I shall read the next verse also, because that's connected with this 47th verse. The 48th verse. Manasaiva pure devaha purvarupam vipashyati anumimamsate apurvam manasa bhagavan ajaha. Translation. The omnipotent Yamaraj is as good as Lord Brahma, for while situated in his own abode or in everyone's heart like the Paramatma, he mentally observes the past activities of a living entity and thus understands how the living entity will act in future lives. Purport. One should not consider Yamaraj an ordinary living being. He is as good as Lord Brahma. He has the complete cooperation of the Supreme Lord who is situated in everyone's heart. And therefore, by the grace of the Super Soul, he can see the past, present and future of a living being from within. The word anumimamsate means that he can decide in consultation with the Super Soul. Anu means following. The actual decisions concerning the next lives of the living entities are made by the Super Soul and they are carried out by Yamaraj. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदी गौरभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। The Yamadutas are elaborately explaining to the Vishnudutas the justification for having come to take Ajamila. So in the course of this description, Shukadeva Goswami is going to help us understand some very, very important facts about this material existence. We should carefully hear this explanation because our tendency in this world is to very comfortably settle down in any damn situation. This is called conditioned life. Many times Srila Prabhupada uses this word, conditioned life. Conditioned life means we get used to a particular set of conditions we are put in and we become complacent. Whether it is human beings or devatas, or less than human beings, lower creatures. Every living being under the influence of the three gunas can become completely competent in any condition. This actually Prabhupada gives us the startling example how a hog is living an abominable life. But the spirit soul, the Atma inside the hog's body is thinking, I am very happy, I am very comfortable, I am enjoying life. So this example in the Bhagavatam is trying to wake us up to the reality. Just like Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Jeev Jago, Gaura Chandra Bole, wake up. Even after joining Krishna Consciousness Movement, the tendency is in whatever situation we are settled down very comfortably, very nicely. But then, the Supreme Lord has got a way of shaking us up, even if we somehow make adjustment and try to settle down. It is the material nature itself, which consists of these three gunas. And these gunas are constantly interacting and producing changes, forcing changes, even if we don't want. Just like our own body. Continuously the body is changing. Whether we may take note of it or not. Time is passing by. Years are rolling. And very soon we are going to meet with death. And death is the ultimate shake-up. But before that, different ways we are shaken up, just like this COVID-19 has shaken up the whole world. Practically everyone is shaken up. Or old age, invalidity due to old age. Will be shaken up. When we take for granted that I am okay, everything is fine. Suddenly something happens and then we are completely thrown off our comfortable situation. So, this description here by the Yamadutas, they are giving a analogy which Srila Prabhupada gives in some other instances also. Just as springtime in the present indicates the nature of springtimes in the past and future, cyclically we have the seasons changing, spring, summer, autumn, winter, generally. So, every year, cyclically the seasons keep appearing and changing. So, just like we can understand, springtime in the present indicates springtime in the future also, because there was springtime in the past. Similarly, the life of happiness, distress are a mixture of both. See, material life, material existence means nobody is completely happy, nobody is totally distressed. There's always a mixture of happiness and distress. Of course, sometimes people seem to be very, very happy. And sometimes they seem to be totally distressed. But it is always coming and going. And there are different proportions of mixtures of the two. Relatively, we may say those in the higher planets are more happy. And those in the lower planets are more distressed. But the living being has got a way of enjoying sense gratification even in hellish conditions. This is what Prahlad Maharaj points out, that even in hell there is sense gratification available. Amid suffering, there is sense gratification available. It is just a question of conditioning in the mind. This perception of sense pleasure is totally relative. Just like the same example of the hog. The hog is actually in abominable condition, but due to conditioning, its own conditioning, it thinks, oh, I am enjoying life. So we may think, based on our present condition, oh, the hog is in a miserable condition. But the conditioned soul within that hog's body is not thinking like that. So does it mean that the hog can live very happily before death comes? No. It has also got the fear. Any time anything can happen. So this conditioned life means there is always happiness, distress, and a mixture of the two So similarly, the present life that we are leading, any living being in this creation, right from Brahma down to the lowest creature, everyone is under the influence of the three gunas, completely controlled by the gunas. Completely controlled by the gunas. Under Kala, the Kala time unfolds. The effect of the gunas. Because according to time, under certain circumstances, Sattvaguna dominates, sometimes Rajoguna dominates, sometimes Tamoguna dominates. So accordingly, people experience happiness, distress, and a mixture of the two. So here, the Yamadutas are telling, evidence regarding religious and irreligious activities of the past and future lives can be understood simply by examining the present. So in the purport, Srila Prabhupada says, our repetition of birth and death is taking place within time, and according to the influence of the modes of nature, we are receiving various types of bodies and being subjected to various conditions. So this punishment by Yamaraj, what is this punishment? Don't think that only somebody is sent to hell, that is punishment. No. Just being forced to accept a material body is itself, in itself, a punishment. Because as soon as we enter a material body, material nature is going to inflict upon us these various happiness and distress, various kinds of happiness and distress. Different times and different situations and different circumstances, and we become conditioned in that particular body to undergo. The material nature itself is of the characteristic of avidya and karma, two characteristics of material energy. We are always in ignorance as long as we are under the material influence of these three gunas. We are in ignorance. So we forget our spiritual nature and we act exactly according to the influence of the gunas. And karma means we are forced to act according to the inducement of the gunas. We are forced to act according to the inducement of the gunas. So some are acting under the mode of goodness, some are acting under the mode of passion, some are acting under the mode of ignorance. So it is not possible to overcome the influence of these gunas or to come to knowledge about our transcendental nature unless one engages in devotional service. Only by devotional service can somebody transcend the influence of the gunas. Mam chayo avyabhicharena bhakti yogena sevate sagunan samadityaitan brahma bhuyaya kalpate. So, by spiritual activities, by transcendental activities, we transcend the modes and then we are able to act in such a way that we can avoid this influence of the gunas. The influence of the gunas means whatever activity we do, we are bound up. We are getting more and more bound up. Whereas acting in devotional service means we are not only avoiding getting more reactions, but we are also freeing ourselves from the bondage of the previous reactions. Two things are happening when we do devotional service. You should always remember. Devotional service itself is action free from all reactions, reaction free activities. And it also frees us from previous reactions. Just like taking prasadam. Prasadam itself will not give you any reaction. But prasadam also purifies us of previous contamination, previous reactions. Muchyante sarvakil vishaihi yajna shishtashinas santo muchyante sarvakil vishaihi. So therefore, Srila Prabhupada says this is very, very significant, very important, that simply by eating only prasadam always, it is guaranteed you are going to become pure. Even if you don't do anything else. Then somebody may say, just Prabhu, I'll eat prasadam, that's all. Why you tell me to do so many other things? Why you tell me I should chant, I should study every day Prabhupada's books? The reason is that we are unable to avoid getting contaminated simply by eating prasadam. If we eat prasadam, definitely that is going to have its effect. But we cannot be inactive rest of the time. You can't be always eating. So you do something else. And that something else you do, unless that is also a devotional service, you are bound to act under the influence of the gunas. Because you always remember, as long as we are in this material world, the gunas are always there. They are everywhere. Even in Brahmaloka also. There is no place in this material creation where the gunas are not acting. The gunas are always acting. So, to keep ourselves free of the influence of the gunas, we have to perform devotional service always, 24 hours a day, at least during the waking hours. We have to do devotional service. If we don't do devotional service, we will act under the influence of the gunas. We are always active as spirit soul. You have to remember this. Always active. Just like Srila Prabhupada says in introduction to Bhagavad Gita, one should realize that if I am not serving Krishna, I am engaged in service of Maya. I'm engaged in service of illusion. So, moment we engage in the service of illusion, even for a little time, again there is that bondage. Again there is bondage. So therefore, having accepted the path of devotional service, it is very important that we are always engaged in devotional service. There is no possibility that somebody some or the other does little devotional service and can become fully purified. To begin with little devotional service, doing little devotional service. But progressively you have to increase. And especially missionaries means dedicated for devotional service. So as missionaries at least we have to all the time, at least all the waking hours, we have to be engaged in devotional service and nothing else. It's very easy if somebody is consciously always engaging in some type of devotional service, authorized devotional service. You will never come under the influence of Maya. You will never come under the influence of the gunas. You have no fear, you have no danger. That's why Krishna says, one of the characteristics of his pure devotees, satatam kirtayanto mam. Satadam kirtayantoma. Ananyas chintayantoma. In so many ways, Krishna explains in the Bhagavad Gita, what is this constant engagement in devotional service? Nitya yuktasya yoginaha. Nitya means always. Without any break. Same sense, avyabhicharini. Avyabhicharini bhakti means without failing in any circumstances. Mamchayo avyabhicharena bhakti yogena sevate. Without failing in any circumstances. So this art of constantly engaging in devotional service is to be learnt from the spiritual master. That's why we have to carefully study Srila Prabhupada's books. We have to carefully follow all the rules and regulations. Srila Prabhupada has given us constant engagement in different ways. We have to be engaged always in devotional service. The example is given that Srila Shukadeva Goswami explains in the second canto while he is speaking to Parikshit Maharaj. Parikshit Maharaj is asking about the creation. So Shukadeva Goswami is explaining, O King, know from me that all living entities are created by the Supreme Lord according to their past deeds. This includes, who all it includes, just here the list. Brahma and his sons like Daksha, the periodical heads like Vaivaswata Manu, the demigods like Indra, Chandra and Varuna, the great sages like Bhrigu, Vyasa, and Vasishta. Hear the names now, you see. The inhabitants of Pitraloka, Siddhaloka, the Charanas, Gandharvas, Vidyadharas, Asuras, Yakshas, Kinnaras, Apsaras, the Serpentines, Nagaloka, residents of Nagaloka, The monkey-shaped Kimpurushas, the human beings, the inhabitants of Matruloka, the demons, Pishachas, ghosts, spirits, lunatics, evil spirits, the good and evil stars, the goblins, the animals in the forest, the birds, the household animals, the reptiles, the mountains, the moving and standing living entities, the living entities born from embryo, from eggs, from perspiration, from seeds. Anybody's left out? No, the universality of this creation. And all others, in case Shukadeva Goswami is covering, in case I left out anybody, whether they be in water, land or sky, in happiness, in distress, or in mixed happiness and distress, everyone is created according to their past deeds by the Supreme Lord Vishnu. All of them, according to their past deeds, are created by the Supreme Lord. So, Shukadeva Goswami continues. Why is he telling this? He is telling this to help us understand. The next verse he says, according to the different modes of material nature, the mode of goodness, the mode of passion, the mode of darkness, there are different living creatures who are known as demigods, human beings, and hellish living entities. Even a particular mode of nature being mixed with the other two is divided into three, and thus each kind of living creature is influenced by the other modes and acquires its habits also. What does this mean? Srila Prabhupada explains. The living entities individually are being conducted by a particular mode of nature, but at the same time, there is every chance of their being influenced by the other two. The devatas are above human beings on the earth. The devatas, they are generally influenced by the mode of goodness. The humans are generally influenced by the mode of passion. Generally means predominantly. Predominantly influenced by the mode of passion. And all lower creatures than the humans are influenced predominantly by the mode of ignorance. But, as Srila Prabhupada says here, as Shukadeva Goswami also explains, always a particular guna is always mixed with the other two. There is no pure goodness in this world, except in pure devotional service. There is no pure goodness. So even the influence of goodness is mixed with influence of passion and the influence of ignorance. Because of this, what happens? That even though one may be situated predominantly in the mode of goodness, there is every possibility of such a person being influenced by the lower two gunas. So, what happens is, Srila Prabhupada explains, in spite of the individual influence of a particular guna, because everyone is trying to lord over material nature to fulfill his individual desire, in spite of the particular influence of one guna, there is the chance of influence of the other gunas. By association, guna sangha. Remember 13th chapter, karanam guna sangosya sadasad yoni janmasu. Why different births in different species? Because of the influence of the gunas. How does this happen? If one is in good association, one can develop the mode of goodness. And if one is in bad association, he may develop the mode of ignorance or darkness. Nothing is stereotyped. One can change his habit by good or bad association. And one has to become intelligent enough to discriminate between good and bad. So whatever the gunas you are situated in, doesn't matter. If you associate, if you have good association, then you can elevate yourself to goodness. And even if one is situated in goodness, if one has bad association, one degrades. The best association is the service of the devotees of the Lord, and by that association one can become the highest qualified man by the grace of the Lord's pure devotees. As we have already seen in the life of Srila Narada Muni, he became the topmost devotee of the Lord simply by the association of pure devotees of the Lord. By birth he was the son of a maidservant and had no knowledge of his father and no academic education, even of the lowest status. Simply by associating with the devotees and by eating the remnants of their foodstuff, he gradually developed the transcendental qualities of the devotees. See the power of association with pure devotees, especially taking the remnants of foodstuff. That's why Prabhupada says, eat only prasadam. Because prasadam means the remnants of food offered to Krishna. So it is very, very powerful. Don't underestimate the power of prasadam. Never underestimate. Because we get it every day, three times, all the times we are getting prasadam, the tendency is to lose value for that. At least those who are traveling, sometimes we have experience that we don't get prasadam and we are in so much difficulty to get prasadam. And we can feel the effect of sometimes not eating prasadam. The difference can be made out. So simply by eating the remnants of foodstuff of the pure devotees and associating with those devotees, he gradually developed the transcendental qualities of the devotees. So if you are taking Radha Krishna Chandra Prasadam, you can develop the transcendental qualities of Radha and Krishna. Krishna is full of all good qualities. Radharani is the topmost devotee of Krishna. So you can develop the topmost qualities of the pure devotee. Simply by taking prasad. But what happens is the attitude, the offensive attitude, actually makes us lose value for that prasadam. Many times we go by what is pleasing to our tongue. Right? If it doesn't agree with my taste, oh, I say, this is not very nice. So then I lose value for the fact that what I am having is prasadam. That's why when honoring prasadam, that prayer, we have to meditate on that prayer. Sharira vidyajal jodendriya tahe kal. Mahaprasade Govinde, Vishwaso Naiva Jayate. The respect, the Shraddha, the faith, the value for prasadam is only if we have the right attitude. Before you actually take prasadam, start honoring prasadam anytime, you have to mentally think, consider, even for a very short time, even for a few seconds, I am the most fortunate soul in the whole creation to get this prasadam. Consider how many people don't have this opportunity to take prasadam. Just look around you. Everywhere, there's so many people who are simply eating sin. That's what Bhagavad Gita says. Bhunjate te to agam papam ye pachanti atma karanat. So, we are the most fortunate souls in the entire creation. Mind you, even the devatas, they cannot easily get prasadam. Somebody wonder, what is the difficulty? Have deity, do deity worship, and then offer food and take prasadam. No, this deity worship itself is a very, very rare thing in the line of bhakti. It's not that we are the only people doing deity worship as devotees of Krishna, following Srila Prabhupada and the Parampara. There are so many other people who do deity worship. But all of them are doing deity worship not as devotional service. The devatas, they do deity worship. For them, the deity worship is an act of the mode of goodness. They are to engage in pious activities to remain in their position. Indra has to retain his position. Every devata have to retain their position. They have to keep accumulating pious credits. Because Shine Punye Martyalokam Vishanti. If they exhaust their pious credits, they come down. So what is the way? Keep on accumulating pious credits. So they're counting. Oh, today I did some puja, today I did some yajna, today I did some tapasya, today I did some dana, today I did some vrata. I got some more punya. They keep counting. Just like businessmen who keep earning, always looking at their passbook or pass sheet or balance. Bank balance is increasing, profit is increasing or profit is coming. So this attitude, they don't have devotion. Even the yajna. Yajna means offering to Vishnu, pleasing Vishnu. But this itself is forgotten by those who are busy with karma kanda. In Swargaloka, everybody is busy with karma kanda. It is shocking to know. But as devotees, we understand this. We should understand this as devotees. Karma kanda, they are busy with karma kanda. Because whatever position they are, either they want to retain their position or they want to go higher. Just like ordinary people in this world also, career-minded, no? Once they get into some job. Or in school also, I want to be the top, I want to score the best marks. Same mentality prevails among the devatas. Of course, there are exceptions. There are devotees among devatas. Those who are engaged in devotional service, them apart. Otherwise, not regular devatas. Devotional service is rare. It's not easily available for everyone. It's available, but it's not easily accepted by everyone. That's the right thing to say. Not accepted by everyone. So, devatas also, they don't take prasadam the way we take in devotional service. Officially they are doing yajna and they are eating yajna shishta only. But it is with the understanding that I am eating this yajna shishta, my pious credits are increasing. So, we should consider ourselves more fortunate than all the devatas. More fortunate than all the devatas. In the Swargaloka, it is Karmakanda which dominates. And above that, Maharloka, Janaloka, Tapoloka, Satyaloka, those planetary systems are for those who are not interested in the enjoyment like the devatas. They are interested in self-realization. So they become busy with Jnana Kanda. Who am I? What is the truth? What is the self? In the 10th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, see, just one line Prabhupada writes that's so significant in one purport. Krishna says, Name vidu suragana prabhavam na maharshayaha aham adirhi devanam maharshinam cha sarvashaha. Neither the hosts of demigods nor the great sages know my origin, for in every respect I am the source of the demigods and the sages. So even the great sages, the maharshis, were always engaged in self-realization. Even they do not know Krishna. They do not know Krishna. So at the end of this purport, because most men cannot understand Krishna in his actual situation, out of his causeless mercy he descends to show favor to such speculators. Yet despite the Supreme Lord's uncommon activity, these speculators, due to contamination in the material energy, still think that the impersonal Brahman is the Supreme. So except for devotees, even the others who are very learned, who are very serious about self-realization, they are all impersonalists. They are all impersonalists. Even the great sages, even the perfected beings, Siddha Loka, the Siddhas, they got all the 8 mystic powers. Ashtasiddhi. Even they, if they become serious about self-realization, they are also impersonalists. Because it's not easy to understand the personal aspect of the absolute truth, the personality of Godhead. Only the devotees who are fully surrendered unto the Supreme Lord can understand by the grace of the Supreme Personality that He is Krishna. The Supreme Absolute Truth is Krishna, or Krishna is the Supreme Absolute Truth. The devotees of the Lord do not bother about the impersonal conception of God. Their faith and devotion bring them to surrender immediately to the Supreme Lord, and out of causeless mercy of Krishna, they can understand Krishna. No one else can understand Him. So the last sentence of this purport is what I wanted to highlight. So, even great sages agree, what is Atma? What is Supreme? It is He whom we have to worship. He means, Prabhupada is writing He. But what is their understanding? Something impersonal. So to worship impersonal Brahman. You have to worship the Supreme. And what is their understanding of Supreme? Impersonal Brahman. That impersonal Brahman we have to worship. So that's why I say most of the great sages and the beings in the upper four planetary systems, Maharloka, Janaloka, Tapoloka, Satyaloka, they are also busy with self-realization and they are trying to perfect the impersonal Brahman understanding. They do not know Krishna. They consider Vishnu as one of the devatas. They consider Vishnu as one of the devatas. Of course, Vishnu is very powerful. So it is not possible to have that devotional attitude even towards such a thing as simple thing as taking prasadam. It's not possible. So we have to be careful. Of course, we don't have any doubt about Krishna being the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But then we take it casually, we become critical about prasadam without having the dominant idea or understanding that this prasadam is, you know, Krishna's remnants of what is eaten by Krishna. And personally, Krishna has actually given this to me. Ultimately, Krishna has to give prasadam. And we are fortunate. Because we are directly staying in Radha Krishna Chandra's house, their home. And we are eating every day. We are honoring prasadam, remnants of Radha Krishna Chandra's prasadam. So, in this attitude towards prasadam will definitely purify us very quickly. Same attitude towards all services that we do to Radha Krishna Chandra. Different kinds of services, whatever it is. We are all servants of Radha Krishna Chandra. But under the direction of Srila Prabhupada, their pure devotee, Acharya, that is important. In the association of devotees, that Narad Muni's example is, in the association of devotees, he was able to actually make quick advancement. Very quick advancement. So, in the association of devotees, always engaging in devotional service, doing service or honoring prasadam with the right attitude, without becoming offensive, unintentionally, not that anybody intentionally does offense, unintentionally even, we should avoid offenses. Being careful to not criticize, be critical. Taittiriya Upanishad says, how a brahmachari, of course it's talking about brahmachari, a brahmachari, annam na nindyat, whatever food he gets, he should never criticize. Annam na parichakshita, never examine that what it is and then based on that eat. He simply has to eat whatever the spirit. He goes for bhiksha in the traditional Vedic culture. What does he do? He goes for bhiksha and he brings whatever bhiksha and offers it to the spiritual master. Then the spiritual master has to call him to accept prasadam. And then whatever the spiritual master gives, he simply has to accept. That is the discipline in the traditional brahmachari training. So Taittiriya Upanishad talks about that for a brahmachari. Annamna parichakshita. Like that, so many statements are there. I remember two. One time I was reciting this before joining every day. So these instructions are very much applicable to us when we take prasadam. For us, anna is annamrita. What does Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur say? Anna becomes annamrita because it's offered to Krishna. And remnants of Krishna is nectar. Annamrita. Say annamrita, khao or pav, whatever. Radha Krishna Gunagao. Glorify Radha and Krishna. You're fortunate to get the remnants. So don't criticize. Of course, due to some health reason, you may not be able to take some item. You can say no. That's okay. But consciously or unconsciously criticizing even service. You may not be able to do some service. That's okay. But don't criticize either the authorities or the service itself, because that service, actually being devotional service, is non-different from Krishna. That's the absolute nature of devotional service, of prasadam, of Krishna, of Krishna's representatives. Absolute nature is non-different from Krishna. So if you criticize some devotional service, you're criticizing Krishna. You criticize prasadam, remnants of food offered to Krishna, Krishna prasadam, you're criticizing Krishna. That's how it becomes an offense. So these offenses have to gradually, why gradually? As far as possible, we have to make it zero. Then very rapid advancement is possible. Very rapid advancement. Very quickly we can become purified. Just like Narada Muni. Just 4 months association, that's all. Over. 4 months association. So it's very, very quickly we can become purified. And then once you're fully purified, then there is no danger. But till that full purification happens, even while you're advancing, the association of devotees, maintaining the best association, as Srila Prabhupada says, only then you elevate, keep on elevating yourself, elevating yourself. Purifying, elevating, purifying, elevating, purifying, elevating. This has to go on till you become 100% pure devotees. In the life of Bharat Maharaj, we have the example in the Bhagavatam. A little inattention fell down. That's why he's so very careful when in the third birth he is born as a son of a Brahmana. Very exalted birth. But he was so very careful. He acted as if he was dumb and deaf and dull. Didn't want to mix with or carried away by any allurement. After all, in his previous life, showing some compassion for some deer, poor deer, it's not a very big maya. But then what happened? Seemingly harmless diversions or distractions also can be very, very dangerous. Can be very dangerous. So that's why constant engagement and association of devotees and becoming free from this tendency to criticize, so that we don't even unconsciously or accidentally or unknowingly make offenses. The offenses are rather obstacle. Criticizing the habit is an obstacle. Taking a leisure or a break and engaging in service of Maya is an obstacle. This we have to realize. So once Prabhupada was asked, last point I'll make and then close. Prabhupada was asked, what about leisure time for devotees? So Prabhupada says, for devotees, actually, there's no leisure time. Because you have to constantly engage in devotional service. But if you change from one type of service to another type of service, that is leisure time. It's like you want to take a break from one type of service. Then take a break means you do some other type of service which is very pleasing to you, which is your favorite. Let's say you sing your favorite kirtan. You read your favorite pastime. Something, some activity which is still devotional service. Because nature of the soul is to be active. So if you're not active in devotional service, you'll be active in Maya service. Sense gratification. And that's the old habit also. So don't fall back to the old habit. Stop it. Nantara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Shri Prabhupada ki jai.